morning, church. How are y'all doing today? God is so good. You know, it's so hot out there. It's a little cooler in here, so we're glad you're here to worship with us. So let's do this.
Here we go.
Gathered here to worship you, Father God. And let's just give them a shout. Let's give them a shout. Let's just, Jesus, we are going to shout from the rooftops how great you are, how much love you have for all of us, Lord. So let's just sing it out.
Thank you. Welcome. Such an exciting day. We're going to be fellowshipping alongside of a lot of our friends from Bethlehem Missionary Baptist Church. That's a mouthful.
Amen.
Almost like ours if you say it in Spanish. I can't do it. He can.
Iglesia Bautista Nueva Vida.
What he said.
But enchiladas on the side.
Welcome, and we're so glad you're here and joining us for worship today. We want to send out a great big thank you to everybody that helped out with the movie night in the park. It was outstanding.
It was.
People were there.
Yes.
Lots of people.
Amen.
Food handlers card. You guys stepped up. You really rock. We love you, New Life.
Amen, and we do love you. Why don't you turn around and tell two or three people good morning. You're glad they came to the house of the Lord.
We love you, Bethlehem, too.
Yes. Amen.
Hello, guys.
Well, y'all did that faster than a smaller crowd earlier today. I thought we were going to have to go ahead and lay out a buffet or something. But anyway, why don't y'all go ahead and be seated for a moment, and just want to say thank you for coming out and worshiping with us. If you're new, this is your first time to visit with us, we'd love to know you, hear from you. And you can help us connect with you by filling out a connection card that's in the pew back in front of you, or just tear out the in your bulletin. later in the service, we will pass the offering plate, and we're asking you as our special guest, just all we're asking for you to drop your information in that bucket, and that way we'll come to know you. Let's just give it up for all of our visitors today. Amen. And amen. Well, I'm going to tell you, God blessed us in the first service, and it was so funny and interesting all at the same time. Pastor Eric and I love him with all of my heart. Boy, I'm going to tell you, he brought heaven down to earth with his words. I can tell you that right now. And but it started before he got to the pulpit. It was because of Bethlehem choir that really brought the angels into our presence. I mean, they lifted up the roof with the praise and worship of God, and we were blessed. So those of you that missed that, you really did miss a blessing. Our production team is trying to figure out how to edit that into our services that you'll be able to watch later on, so that you'll be a part of that as well. I do want to say thank you, as Denny's already mentioned, to all of you that have worked or contributed in some way to the movie night outreach. And because of that, we were able to connect with lots of people. We were able to serve them through our concession trailer and through many of you that served snow cones, popcorn, and cotton candy, and I don't even know what all, but there was a constant line going on.
About 750 hot dogs?
750 hot dogs or so. People were hungry. Amen. So that's what it's all about, and let's just give God big praise for that. Amen. You know, because people say, well, why do y'all do that? We do that so that we can tell somebody that doesn't know how good God is. Amen. And he's the thing that changes everything in our life. Now, what was funny, as I started saying a while ago, was that Pastor Eric, he brought heaven down to earth through the words and just was a true servant of the living God today. And he pulled me over to the side right after the service. We're still on the platform. He says, God has given me a different word for the second service. Is that okay? And I said, that's normal. That's pretty normal. And I leaned over and I told my wife while we were worshiping a while ago, I said, he hadn't even been here two full services, and God's already doing that. And unless you're a minister, you don't know what that really means.
Unless whenever you're a minister's wife, really don't know what that means. Because, yeah, Don, I don't know if that makes you nervous, but I'm like, okay, here we go. I'll just hold on for the ride.
But how many agrees that we'd rather have somebody in our pulpit that would listen to the Lord and not man?
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
So we have that man. And he's going to share that word with you in a moment. But God's word says in Matthew's gospel, 25th chapter and the 40th verse, Jesus said, the king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. Now, the Holy Spirit wants to remind us today that sometimes we're entertaining angels and we don't even know it. And that's why it's so important that we always put our best foot forward. That person that's in that grocery line checking you out sometimes, or maybe you're in another department, or maybe you're at McDonald's. I know none of y'all go there. Or the taqueria, you have no choice but to go there. But sometimes when you're dealing with people, you don't realize what had happened in their life that day or that week. They may not have only been having a bad day or a bad week. They may have been having a bad life. And what God wants us to remember, that we're always to bring forth kindness in all things. And here's the promise of God's word, is that, listen, when you are a blessing, you will receive blessings into your life. Right. So listen, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we're like, well, nobody knows how bad I hurt. Nobody knows the problems that I'm facing and the struggles. Well, maybe that's true. Maybe people get caught up in their own life, but nobody knows. Somebody knows his name is Jesus. And the greatest way to get that blessing, that healing in your life, is to be an extension of his love to somebody else. Nothing feels better than be able to help somebody else. And it doesn't matter if it's a snow cone, popcorn, cotton candy, or a hot dog, or whatever it is, just doing some act of kindness. God says that everything you do, he says, is noticed by me and recorded, and you will one day be blessed for it when you get into heaven. He will reward you for that. So just remember that God wants you to be a blessing, okay? Amen. Everybody say blessing.
Blessing.
Turn around and tell two or three people that you need to be a blessing today. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Everybody has problems. Everybody has problems. But no, listen, we don't have to carry those problems. We can give them to the problem solver. His name is Jesus. Come on, let's get ready to worship. Let's stand up to our feet. Let's just bathe this thing in prayer. Father, we just love you. Thank you for glory. Thank you for meeting us here. God, we don't want you to pass through this place. We want you to come in and sit here. We want to bask in your glory. In Jesus' name, all God's people will shout. Amen. Amen.
Holy, holy, holy.
Thank you, Jesus. You know, God's love for us is so powerful and so strong. We, as a people, as a society, have just kind of cheapened that word love. When we talk about God's love, we have to add His love is powerful. His love is faithful. His love is everlasting. And here's another word. Let's add His love is fierce, because He's going to pursue us relentlessly. So thank you, Jesus, for your awesome love today. Before I call, before I ever cry, you answer me from where the thunder hides. I cannot run, this heart I'm tethered to. With every step, I can lie with you.
Sing it out.
Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce, you cannot fail. The only thing I found is through it all, never let me down. You don't hold back, relentless in pursuit. At every turn, I come face to face with you. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce.
Thank you, Jesus. You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce, like a tidal wave crashing over. Rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. Your love.
Lover of our souls. Just Father, just continue to fan the flames that you have started within our hearts. Some of the flames have grown dim. Others are burning hot. But Father, we pray, just continue to fan those flames, that it becomes our desire to honor you, Jesus, to serve you, to worship you, to go outside these walls and to serve you by loving your people, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I pray that it is our desire and that it burns deep, deep down with us. Thank you, Jesus. My desire is you. My first love is you. My soul longs for you, Jesus. Sing it out, my desire. My desire is you. My first love is you. My soul longs for you, Jesus. So here I am. So here I am upon your altar, consuming fire burning me. And I will rise to seek your face, oh Lord. All consuming fire burning me. It's my desire. My desire is you. My first love is here I am. So here I am upon your altar, all consuming fire burning me. And I will rise to seek your face, oh Lord. All consuming fire burning me. Here I am, Lord. So here I am upon your altar, all consuming fire burning me. And I will rise to seek your face, oh Lord. All consuming fire burning me. Have your way. Have your way. Have your way. All consuming fire burning me. Have your way. Have your way. All consuming fire burning. Sing it out from the bottom of our hearts. Have your way. Have your way. All consuming fire burning me. Have your way, have your way. All consuming fire burning me. So here I am. So here I am upon your altar. All consuming fire burning me. And I will rise to seek your
Shout of praise. God is a good God. And all the time, God is good. Amen and amen. Let's pray. And God, right now, we are so grateful to be able to be in the house of God. And that, God, we are so blessed this morning to be able to know we're going to hear a word from God, knowing that we will leave different from the way we came in here. And we just pray that you'll find our hearts ready to receive that word that you have specifically and specially for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Please be seated. Well, you know, there's certain people that God places in your life throughout your life that just brighten your day and make your life better. And specifically where you're in the ministry, they claim that one of the most lonely positions or jobs to have is to be a minister of the gospel, because you, although we're around many people, you can't be around people in the way that you feel that you need to be around people. And then God is faithful to his service because he puts those special people in his life. And I've been blessed throughout my last 20 years in this church of preaching the gospel, and specifically over the last previous years up to this date, bringing Pastor or Reverend Eric Tarver into my life, because out of all of the ministers, I love them all, but he's the one who has made the biggest impact in my life and blessed me. And he's here and he wants to share with you a word that God has given him to be able to bring into our lives to help us be better at what God has called us to, the life he's called us to. So church family, if you would, along with me, just give a big, warm, new life welcome to Pastor Eric Tarver. Amen.
And the people of God said amen. Amen again to Pastor Jesse and to Sister Deanie and the entire staff of the New Life Church. We greet you in the joy of God. Of course, we also make mention of campus pastors Sharon and Pettis. Those of you that are watching via the World Wide Web, amen. I hope I'm not critiqued too bad on the internet. I'm kind of reluctant to even log on Facebook to see who wants to throw tomatoes at me from the previous service. Amen. I am happy to be here, your pastor, my brother and my friend, as he has suggested. I don't have too many friends in ministry, but your pastor is one of my best friends. And you ought to show him some love, if you would. Show him some love. Let me thank the staff, Pastor Steve, and also Brother Dave for catering to my old-fashionedness. I preach from a pulpit every Sunday, and so I feel somewhat out of place unless I have a podium, and so they have seen fit to make sure I have a pulpit, and I thank God for them. I want to recognize my wife. She's right in the middle, Dawn, so try not to talk too bad about the sermon. She will hear you, and she will get you straight. Amen? Amen. Pastor Jesse had told me I can preach the same sermon twice. I was led to go another direction. When we finish here, we're going to go back to Bethlehem and preach our service, so it'll be three times. So not so much of a grand slam, but maybe a home run. So we're going to not going to be before you long. Let me invite your attention to two passages of scripture. God bless you, baby. Amen. And just let her, I love children. Just let her roam around, whatever you do. Children don't distract me. Grown folk who chase them distract me. So just let her. Amen. I know about children. I've got two grand. So just let them run. Two passages of scripture. The first one will be coming from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 5 and 6. The second one would be coming from Genesis chapter 5 and the first portion of verse 24, what is called 24a. I know that it is not theologically correct to read the New Testament first before the Old whenever you're preaching, but I want to set this up the way that we need to set it up. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5 and 6, the New King James Version is also on the screen. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death and was not found, for God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. That's in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5. But verse 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to him, to God, must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Genesis chapter 5, 24a. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. And I just want to talk about a spiritual resume worth having. A spiritual resume worth having. When I was matriculating from Bastrop High School, class of 1993, I was required to take an elective, and I elected to take a Business Professional of America class, which would prepare me for what lied ahead in the future. In that Business Professional of America's class, we were taught how to write a resume. A resume is a piece of paper or papers, depending on how you beef up your resume, required to give a brief biological sketch of your education and your employment history. This document is used for people to know whether or not you have met the requirements considered for employment. There are two functional aspects of a resume. They first of all talk about the functions. What can you do? But then it talks about the chronological, the time. What can you do and how long have you done it? Now, I will say that I am bothered, Pastor Jesse, by people that have extensive and evasive resumes. I really am. Because some of your information is false. It got quiet. That's okay. Some of your information is false. I remember it was a young man who I knew personally, and he was applying for a church, and this church called me as a reference, and this young man and I are the same age, and on his resume he had put down that he graduated from Bishop College of Dallas, Texas. Well, I know for a fact that Bishop College of Dallas, Texas shut down in May of 1989. Now, how can you graduate high school in 1994 and attend Bishop College? Well, the church contacted me, said, Brother Tarver, so-and-so has you down for a reference, and we're going down his records and all that, and it says that he has a bachelor degree from Bishop College. I said, that's impossible, because I was going to go to Bishop. My dream was to go to Bishop and then off to Morehouse ITC in Atlanta, Georgia. I said, I wanted to go to Bishop College, but Bishop College shut down when I was a freshman in high school. And so if it shut down when I was a freshman, he was probably in the eighth or ninth grade as well. So literally, he lied on his resume. Usually, the impressive the resume is, the better your chances are getting hired. Some people will even go to great lengths as to hire professional resume writers to write their portfolio, because they understand that the doors of opportunity can be open or shut based upon how impressive or how unimpressive their resume is. The text that we read beforehand, Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, it's like reading the resumes of the heroes of faith. I believe that Paul W. Powell would call it the resumes of the unredeemed. Someone would call it Faith Hall of Fame. These were not perfect people, but yet they made the Hall of Fame. It speaks about their accomplishments, their attainment, and how they accomplished it all through faith. When I look in Hebrews chapter 11 and I look at some of the people in Faith Hall of Fame, when I look at Abraham's resume, Abraham has a very impressive resume. He had a lot to put on his resume. When I look at Moses' resume is just as impressive. I can say Abraham became the father of the faithful. God changed his name. He became a friend of God. He is the father of Israel. Moses' resume could be that he was born to a Hebrew woman. She placed him in the Nile River with pitch so he would not sink into the Nile River and be devoured by alligators. Pharaoh's daughter bathing in the Nile River, hears a baby, and she hears it go, tells her servants to fetch this baby from the Nile River. When she sees him, he starts to crying. His tears are relative to his name being called Moses. He's being raised in the Egyptian kingdom, becomes Pharaoh's adopted grandson, has all of the amenities and all of the flexibilities of being the prince of Egypt. That is an impressive resume. But when I look at this young man by the name of Enoch, Enoch did not have a whole lot to put on his resume. And so what happens when you don't have a good resume? If your resume isn't looking too good, you beef it up. And in your beefing it up, you start stretching the truth. But in case you don't understand, there is no such thing as stretching the truth. Because whenever you stretch the truth, you are literally lying. Somebody may say, well, I just told a little white lie. I didn't know that lies had color. Because there is no such thing between a little white lie and a little black lie. A lie is a lie. But some people will lie about some things just to make their resume impressive. 20 years ago, I believe there was a college football coach by the name of George O'Leary that left Georgia Tech University. He had been hired by the University of Notre Dame. He was going to become their next football coach. He had followed Bob Davie. George O'Leary said that he had a master's degree in educational development from a university, and Notre Dame researched it, and it only come to find out he had taken a leadership class in education. 5 days on the job, he had to resign because he had lied. The head coach of the Manhattan college basketball team, young man that played for Rick Pitino at the University of Kentucky, helped them to win a national championship in 1998, got his head coaching job in Manhattan. A young aspiring coach put on his resume that he had a bachelor's degree from the University of Kentucky. Cool, it's all good. You went there, you played there, but he was a few hours short. What happened? He had been hired by the University of South Florida, I believe, and they did a background check only to find out he did not finish his degree at Kentucky. What happened? He had to go back to his job. His job says you come back only under the condition that you finish your degree. He lied about his resume. If Abraham and Moses could talk this morning, they may say, Enoch, hey man, you don't have a whole lot to fill out on your resume. And your resume, Enoch, is not as impressive as ours. But Enoch could say, I don't have a lot to say. Don't have a whole lot to put on my resume. I know that. Moses, I know my resume is not impressive as yours. And Abraham, I know that my resume is not too extensive. He would say that it's not even a whole lot about me in the Bible, because there are only 5 passages of scripture that talks about me. But I want to tell you, I do have an impressive spiritual resume. I can hear Moses and Abraham in dialogue. Come on, Enoch, tell us about your resume. And Enoch will say, all I can tell you is that my name is Enoch. I had faith in God. I pleased God. I believed in God. I was a faithful follower and searcher of God. And one day he took me home. That's my resume. Well, Abraham and Moses in dialogue still. Tell us more, Enoch. He will say, well, I'm Adam's great grandson. I am the father of Methuselah. I'm Noah's great grandfather. But if you want more, let me tell you this. Number one, I put my confidence in God. Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. And my friends, I cannot please God by having only religion. Let me say that again. Anybody can please God, but I cannot please God just by having religion. Religion is just something I do out of habit, but my relationship is something I do out of my faith. I am a Christian because of my religion. That's my Christianity. I cannot deny the fact that I believe in Jesus the Christ, the one who was born of the Virgin, the one who went about doing good, the one who died on Calvary and that was buried and was resurrected and now sits on the right hand of the Father. I am a Christian. That is my religion. But I cannot have religion without a relationship. And it's sad, my brothers and sisters in Christ, at how many folk can brag about their religion, but they don't have a relationship. Now, don't talk too fast now, but how many of you literally got up this morning and put your face in the book before you got on Facebook? Don't wave your hand this morning, but how many of you literally got up and talked to God in prayer before you sent a text message? How many of you literally, before you got out of the bed and placed your feet on the floor, before you got your morning coffee, you fell down on your knees and told the Lord, thank you. That is, I can tell the battery's going down, it's going out of something. That's all right, I got a loud voice. Amen. I put my confidence in God. And if I'm going to please God, I've got to have faith in God. And Enoch would say, I put my faith and confidence in God, and my faith is to trust him, to rely on him, to put my faith in God is to please God. Faith is like this. Faith is just like jumping off a high cliff after being chased by the enemy or by somebody that don't like me and jumping off and knowing that somebody's going to catch me. That's what faith is. Faith is just like not having a dime to your name and your change is strange and your money is funny and your quarter is shorter and your nickel is fickle and your penny is lenny and you ain't got no money to pay your bills, but yet you will still call CPNL or AEP and they'll tell you you got an extension. That's faith. Faith is not having anything to really have in your life. It's almost like having a disease that the doctor said it cannot be cured, and yet you don't put your trust in the doctors. You put your trust in the deity, and when doctors have shaken their head in disbelief of saying you won't live when you come back for a checkup, they shake their head in belief to know that you're a child of the Most High God. That's what faith is. And so faith is to trust, to rely on God. He says, I put my faith in God. I pleased God. I like how he says it in Hebrews. He says, because I believe that he is. And that's present tense. He said, I don't believe that God was. He said, I believe that he is, the self-existing Jehovah. He is. I believe that he is. I believe that he is real. And whenever you give a person a name, you validate their personhood. Who is God? God is. I really cannot tell you that he is or what he is, because he is too many to name. It is so extensive. It is so evasive. I can call him Jehovah. I can call him Elohim. I can call him I am that I am, his first, middle, or last name, but I know that he is. The only way for me to get what I got coming from God is that I first of all have to realize that God is. Now, many people really don't know about how you do it, because they're wondering, how can you trust in a God that is only is? Can I just kind of tell you that? If I trust in him because he is, the blank can go on and on and on and on, and it's like a rerun of blessings. Because he is. He says, not only am I is, he said, but I'm also am. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. Man got to come through me before they go to God. And Enoch is talking about his resume, man. He is saying, I believe that God is real because God has a name. Yes, he does. He has a name. And let me just kind of make a few folk upset. God's name is not the man upstairs. Oh, I know you say it, but I cannot call him the man upstairs because stairs have limitations. He is not the big guy in the sky, because he is more than up here. Oh, bless his name. And so God is I am, and there is evidence. And I know for a fact that God is, because of the creation. I know for a fact, and I learned in school, my friends, about the Big Bang Theory and all of that and how we evolved. No, man, it wasn't a Big Bang Theory, because if it was a Big Bang, who was behind the bang? I know about Charles Darwin and evolution, but I've got some bad news for you. We did not evolve. Did not evolve from some kind of molecule. We did not evolve from some kind of animal and all of that. No, God himself took the dust, a byproduct of dirt, from the ground and made him a man and breathed unto him living life. That's how we were made. I am aware also about how God exists and that he is and that I am, because the earth sits 93.2 million miles from the sun. Let me say that again. 93.2 million miles away from the sun. He put the sun just right. Pastor Jesse, if he put it too close, I would burn up. If he put it too far away, I would freeze. Now, I do know that El Nino produces some hot summers and some colder winters and some rain that falls when it wants to, but I do thank God for placing the earth 93.2 million miles away from the sun. Let me tell you something else. I also thank him for allowing the tilt of the earth on its axis to ensure seasons, which literally gives me 365.256 days out of the year. And as the earth is revolving around the sun, it is rotating 24 hours a day on its axis. It allows sunshine to be down under while nighttime is in Texas. I do appreciate the fact of his existence because I read about in the beginning and what God did. And if God did it and he said so, then it became into being. And so he says, I put my confidence in God. I put my confidence in God so much until I am not ever going to deny the existence of God. I need to say this too, because we're living in a day of what is called postmodernism. Postmodernism is suggesting today that people are trying to hijack God's moral and God's intellect. They are suggesting that God don't exist, and even if he does exist, they want God himself to come down and show them that he does exist. They attack his moral. They attack his intellect. They have this attitude about, you cannot make me believe what I don't want to believe, and you cannot make me behave like I don't want to behave. If I want to choose to trust in God or believe in God, then so be it. And what God does, God shows us in signs that I still am God. Enoch would say, I put my confidence in God. He said, but also I know his promise. His promise is that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I put my confidence, I put my communion in God. You know, he says, man, me and God, we are buddies, we are partners, we are coffee buddies. Me and God, we parlay together. And every now and then, on a daily basis, you and God ought to have a daily appointment. Don't ever allow distraction, and they do come up, stop you from having an appointment with God. And my friends, in this world that we're living in today, somebody has canceled their appointments. I'm sorry, every time I hear pops like that, I start kind of, okay, now I'm, where's my security team at? I don't mean no harm. All right, okay. Back to the program. Every time I start hearing pops, I kind of, yeah, hit the ground. Last night, at about 6 p.m. in my hometown of Bastrop, Texas, a deranged lunatic husband shot 4 family members and then killed himself. I knew that family. 5 people. I think God is asking for an appointment. In Dallas, 5 police officers. In Baton Rouge, 3 police officers after a young man got killed. St. Paul, Minnesota. I think God is asking for an appointment. And my friends, I don't care what convention you watched last week. I don't care what convention you're going to watch this week. I don't care if it's Trump or Hillary. God is asking for an appointment. And the appointment is not going to come from us trying to sling mud at who we are. You cannot come together as his people as long as you want to bring up the rap sheet of those that you know. I said this earlier. I majored in English, but ain't nobody perfect. And you ain't all that and a bag of chips and a Butterfinger for nothing. Baby, you got some faults like everybody else. Matter of fact, the person sitting next to you got faults. I got faults. You got faults. Everybody got faults. And if we were true and real to ourselves every day, we can say thank God for his saving grace and mercy and loving kindness, because he looked beyond all of our faults and he saw our need. Put my confidence in God. And so if I put my confidence in God, I walked with God. Walking is imperative to living. I'm almost through. I got to go to Bethlehem. It's imperative of living. Enoch would say, no. My resume, Abraham and Moses, it's not impressive to y'all, but I do have a constant walk. I've got a close walk. I've got a calm walk. I've got a celebrated walk. And I walked with God for 300 years. Matter of fact, I walked with God so long until I kept walking with him and lost track of the walk. Sound man, I can't hear myself. I lost track of the walk. I mean, I walked with God so long until God said, Enoch, since you have walked with me, you might as well just keep on walking. And I'm going to change your address. And so Enoch would say this. He says, I put my confidence in him. I know his promises. But then he changed my address. In case you didn't know, Enoch did not need the business of Trevino Funeral Home. Because guess what? Enoch, he didn't have a funeral. The Bible says that he walked with God and God took him. And if God took him, he really didn't die. God just took him. It's almost like when Elijah was captured in the chariots, and the chariot came down and swooped him up. He was translated. Enoch walked with God so long until God says, Enoch, you tired? No, I'm not tired, but I kind of feel kind of weary. Well, come on home with me. You walk with me for so long. You live with me. I'm just going to take you with me. And so your address will change. And my friends, let me tell y'all something here. The longer you walk with God, the more chances you have on having your address in a better place. Your address can either be north or it can be south. It can be in non-smoking or it can be in smoking. It can be in heaven, or it can be in hell. I remember when I was driving to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, to our national convention some years ago, and my foot kind of got heavy around Orange, Texas. Orange, that's on the border of Louisiana and Texas, and Orange, Texas. And I remember that I thought I saw flashing lights. No, I wasn't running away from the trooper or the county, whatever it was. But I remember that when I crossed over the state line, he turned around. because I was not in his jurisdiction. I've got good news for you. Death cannot touch you if it's not in your jurisdiction. Enoch walked with God, and God changed his address. Abraham, Moses, and Enoch are talking. Abraham and Moses saying, man, our resumes are all that. They're good, man. But Enoch, your resume ain't worth nothing. And Enoch saying, well, I told y'all, I walked with God. I put my confidence in God, and I put my faith in God, and God changed my address. Well, Enoch, I've got a question now as I'm talking out of my third person. I need another resume. Talk to me about another. I need to know why your resume was so impressive. And Enoch would say, because I knew God's resume. And if I asked Enoch to tell me about God's resume, I would say, Enoch, what is God's name? He'll tell me, which one do you want? Too many to name. I mean, we can call him Jehovah Jireh. We can call him Jehovah Rofiki, or Jehovah Shalom, or Jehovah Sabaoth. Maybe we can call him El Shaddai. I need to know his name. But then Enoch would say, well, I gave you his names, but too many to name. Well, what is his work experience? He'll say, do you not know that he created the heavens and the earth? And that he's perfect, precious, persistent, he's passionate, he's everlasting, he is captivating. Enoch, does he have any references? Shame on you, Eric Tarver. Yes, he does. Ask Israel. Well, what did he do? He delivered them from Egypt, gave them manna in the morning, quail in the evening, water from the rocks in the driest places. I need more. Well, talk to Daniel. Daniel can tell you about the lion's den. Talk to Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. They can tell you that he will fall in the furnace. I need more references. Well, talk to Mary and talk to Martha. They'll tell you that he knows how to resurrect dead folk because he raised their brother from the dead. Talk to David. David will tell you that he is a shepherd. He's light. He's lamp. Well, I need more. I need more references. And he'll say, well, I really cannot prove anything else to you, but you've got to look at yourself and remember, have a flashback about what God has done. I'll talk to Enoch. Enoch, does he have any children? Yes, he does, because he loves all the little children of the world. Red, yellow, black, and white, they are all precious in his sight. But he had one begotten son that he gave for the whole wide world. That son that they called Jesus the Christ, Mary's little lamb, Mary's baby, raised by Joseph the carpenter, went about doing good, turned a desert into a delicatessen, and put sight in blind man's eyes, unstopping deaf ears, unloosing stammering tongues. You know the one that died on Calvary. You know the one that was buried. You know the one that got up on that third day morning and now sits on the right hand of his own father. But Enoch, I need more. I'm sorry that I'm worrying you, Enoch, but what can you tell me about this God? Well, I can tell you that he's a rock in a weary land. He's shelter in the time of a storm. He's a friend when you're friendless. He's bread when you're hungry. He's water when you're thirsty. He's Adam's redeemer. He's Abel's vindicator. He's Abraham's sacrifice. He's Noah's ark. He's Moses' bush on fire. He's Joshua's battle axe. He is the fleece of Gideon. Samson's power, David's music, Solomon's wisdom, Jeremiah's balm in Gilead, Ezekiel's wheel in the middle of a wheel. He is distinctive and supernatural capacity. He is superlative and sovereign majesty. He is exclusive and spiritual beauty, radiant and eternal splendor, and matchless in deity. That's too many big words. Can you break it down? Yes. He's all right. Mm-hmm. And as I go to Bethlehem, I just have one question this morning. And help me out, but if I ask, ain't he all right? And you'll say, yeah. I don't hear you, but ain't he all right?
Yeah.
I said, ain't he all right?
Yeah.
Yes, he is. God bless you. God keep you is our prayer. But that is a spiritual resume worth having. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for the word that has been preached. Thank you for Pastor Jesse and the New Life Church, for the vision that they have for the community, of placing unity in the community. Bless us as we journey even down the street to share with your people at the Bethlehem Church. Bless us throughout this day. Continue to give us strength from on high, as we do need your strength and your power. In Jesus' name, amen.
And amen.
My friends, I normally don't leave before the benediction, but I do have to get to Bethlehem. I wanted to give my offering in the last service, but they ran off, didn't get my money, but I'm leaving my offering.